The Lord is our light and our salvation.
Why should we be afraid?
The Lord is the stronghold of our life.
What have we to fear?
Let us shout with joy to God.
Let us sing and make music before our God.
Let us pray. O God, our light and our salvation, shelter us in your love. O God, our stronghold, protect us from danger. We come with shouts of joy to worship you this day. We come with song and music to celebrate your love. We come with longing to seek your presence. Be with us now, O God, as we sing your praises. Amen.
Thank you. Kind of a new grandmother, right? I got a little grandbaby. She's two. She's gonna be two. So the only thing that anybody told me to do as a grandmother is, this is called grandma candy. Because when my boys were little, my mother always had this candy at their house, at her house, and they were allowed to get as much as they want. So here's one for each of you. You can take one. Okay, so besides grandma candy, what else should I do? What kind of things do grandmas do? Oh, they take their grandchildren out for more fun things than the parents. Got you there, girl. You don't know? Oh, goodness. Well, your grandparents aren't here to defend themselves, unfortunately. You want to tell us something grandparents do?
Go on a hike.
Oh, go on a hike together. That's a great thing. Oh, I can do those things. I can sure have more fun than the parents. But you know, that's kind of the way it is, Maggie. You really hit the nail on the head. When I was a little girl, my parents made me go to church. Made me go to church. I had to go to church. Get up and go to church. Get dressed, you gotta go to church. Then when I went to visit my grandpa, it was a whole different world. This is a picture of my grandpa telling me stories, me and my sister, stories. My grandpa was a farmer and he got up really early in the morning to work and he worked hard. So in the afternoon, he'd come in and lie down for a little while and kind of try to take a nap. And he'd tell us stories, like David and his big slingshot that kills lions and bears. And he'd tell us about beautiful Esther, the queen, the beauty queen who became queen. And he'd tell us about Daniel in the lion's den and how God shut the mouths of the lions. Well, I thought, church is pretty cool, and we wanted to go to church at Grandpa's house. So this is a picture of my sister and me all dressed up in our little matching dresses, ready to go to church at Grandpa's house. Much happier than we did at home. So the nice thing about what my grandpa did is he gave me a foundation in my faith. He was the beginner of my faith journey. He told me all those stories, and then you know what? Later on, I read my Bible, and there they were. Right there in my Bible. So my grandfather is one of my most fond memories of my childhood, telling me stories and teaching me about God. He loved God and he loved to read the Bible and he loved to tell us stories. So grandparents, you have a charge now. Tell stories to your grandkids. You don't have to do it lying down on the couch like that, but I do recommend it. Tell stories to your grandchildren and give them a good start. You guys want to say thanks to your grandparents?
Thanks to your grandparents.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Now let's all wave to the grandparents out here. Thanks, grandparents. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for giving us grandparents who love us so dearly and who teach us your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
scripture today comes from the Gospel of John, the 8th chapter, the 12th verse. Jesus spoke to the people again, saying, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me won't walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. So if you've never participated in planning a worship service, you may not realize that each part, each piece, every aspect of the service is carefully thought about and put into place to help those who are worshiping and to connect with God. And here at Main Street, we have a worship planning team that helps us think about our worship services. And we take seriously our second core value, which is meaningful worship. So everything from the order of worship, you know, what we do when in the service, to the color and style of the pyramids, which is what's here on the pulpit and on the altar, to whether or not the choir wears robes, to the children's sermon who celebrated Grandparents' Day today, everything, even something as simple as when we ask the congregation to stand or sit, all of it is intentionally designed to help us connect to God so that we can have a meaningful worship service, and through this time together we can hear what God is wanting us to hear. This pandemic has also helped us to focus even more on our online worship and all of the details that are involved to help make worshiping online meaningful for those who do it that way. And one aspect of worship that is really important and symbolic is the lighting of the altar candles. You know, even when we were not worshiping in person and we were just still recording all of our worship services, we still made sure that the altar candles were lit for those times. Now, we still haven't begun to use acolytes here yet. It's another pre-COVID aspect of worship that we're looking forward to bringing back, and we're working towards that. Our acolytes are an important part of worship because as they come into the worship space, they're bringing the light of the world into the service. They're symbolically bringing Jesus into the service. And these candles, they stay lit throughout the service in order to focus on the light of the world. And then another aspect of worship that we've been missing but is very powerful is that the acolytes then take the light of the world out in front of the congregation. They lead us out to guide us and to remind us that we too are then taking the light of the world out into the world. Today we're continuing our I Am worship series. And Jesus used these I Am statements to help his followers to understand who he was. Mark Barber explains that these words, I Am, were used in such a way to help us think about God's revelation to Moses at the burning bush. When Moses asked for God's name and God replied, "I am who I am." That first I am in the Greek translation of Exodus is exactly the same form that Jesus uses here. I am. In our scripture today, Jesus says, "I am the light of the world." And this statement comes right after some legal experts and Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery to Jesus, and they asked him, what should we do with her? This situation was full of darkness. It was full of pain and jealousy and anger and sexism and deception and revenge. It was so much darkness. And what does Jesus do? He brings light to the situation. As Matthew Parker writes, the light is the light of God. That light that exposes the sin and hypocrisy of the crowd who wanted to hurt the woman and to trap Jesus. That light treats the law of God with respect. That light reveals the heart of God, which is the heart of grace and mercy. See, Jesus didn't say, well, she got away with it this time, but next time I may not be around to stop them. No, Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. Go and sin no more. That's what Jesus, the light of the world, does in this situation. He brings light to it. See, Jesus, because he is the light of the world, he is able to bring light to any darkness. He is able to bring good out of bad. He is able to bring healing when there is pain. He is able to bring love when there is hate. This light, this love is essential to who Jesus is. Because he too is I am. He is God, and God is love. Part of a story that Matthew Stahl shares in one of his messages is about a student who's challenging his professor. And the student asks, he says, "Professor, does darkness exist?" And the professor responds, "Well, of course it does." And the student replied, "Well, once again, sir, you're wrong. Darkness does not exist either. Darkness is really the absence of light. Light we can study, but not darkness. In fact, we can use Newton's prism to break white light into many colors and study the various wavelengths of each color. You can't measure darkness. A simple ray of light can break into a world of darkness and illuminate it. How can you know how dark a certain place is? You measure the amount of light that is present." Isn't that correct? Darkness is a term that is used by humanity to describe what happens when no light is present. Okay, that makes sense, yes? So without God in our life, without a relationship with Jesus, without knowing I am, without the light of the world, we're left in the dark. We will be consumed by the pain that people inflict on one another. We'll be focused on the anger and the animosity people have towards those who are different from them. We will see all of the negative, hurtful, divisive aspects of our world and of our community. And we'll live in darkness. But Jesus is the light that can eliminate all that darkness. Jesus is the light that helps us to see the love. To see the love and the people who are helping those in pain. to see the love in the people who are sharing what they have with those in need. To see love in the sacrifices people are making to care for someone else. Jesus, the light of the world, helps us to see love. Jesus said, "Whoever follows me won't walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." So how do we walk in the light? How do we have this light of life? John Wesley, the founder of Methodism, offered his three general rules to walk in the light. His three general rules are: do no harm, do all the good possible, and stay in love with God. These rules, they sound kind of vague, but they really are good guidance when making decisions. They are a good way for us to stay in the light. This idea that Jesus, the light of the world, lights things up enough so that we can see in the darkness, so that we can walk in the light. It connects with what Jesus said in Matthew 5:14 when he's speaking to his followers, which includes us, and he says, you are the light of the world. See, when we believe in Jesus, when we live as his followers, then the light of Jesus is in us. We then take Jesus' light in us and are able then to light the world. And others know the light because of us. Their darkness is pierced because we have shared the light. Friends, we are connected to the light of the world. We are sharing with the world this light when we bring in jars of peanut butter for the Food for Kids backpack program. We are connected to the light. We're sharing the light when we keep the blessing box stocked, when we deliver wood for our wood ministry, when we share with our children and with our grandchildren and with the community, the children in the community, the good news of Jesus Christ. When we invite our friends and neighbors and even strangers to join us in worship. When we pay for the order of the person behind us in the drive-through line. When we cheer on our frontline heroes through this pandemic, when we reach out to someone who is shut in and lonely and just in need of some companionship, when we speak up about injustice issues, all of these are ways that we share the light of the world with the world. And Jesus' light shines through us. One of the ways that I saw the light this week, our preschool has been back in session about a week and a half. And this is just a simple way. All of the students and the parents are still getting used to their schedule. And this week there was a little girl. She was having a meltdown in the hallway. She was laying down flat on the ground, bawling her eyes out. She was inconsolable. So I'd peek at my office just to kind of see what's going on. And I saw one of our wonderful preschool teachers was with her. And she was offering such kind, sweet, caring words of comfort, calming this little girl down. And she was able to get her calmed down enough so that she got back up and walked back into the class on her own. That's just one of the ways I saw the light this past week. I want to share another that just came this morning. This is just really sweet. There's a lady in our community who is very ill. She's a neighbor to some of our congregants, and I've been visiting her some, and she can't do a whole lot to share her faith. She can't do a whole lot to let people know and see the light of Christ in her, but she loves making crafts. And she made these, and I'm supposed to share these with the staff. She made this one for me because she knew pink was my favorite color. So she made me this little star. This is someone who doesn't leave her home. She stays at home. She can't get out of her chair. She's basically sitting in the chair all the time. But she cared enough about God and about God's children that she's making these to share with people the way she can. And she gave this and brought this through members here to me and to be able to share with people. Friends, doing something like this is the way that we share the light of Jesus. It's the way that we share the light of the world and offer it back into the world so that others can know that light and can help them with the darkness that's in their life. I pray this week that you will be able to find a way to see that light in the midst of whatever darkness that you're going through. But also that you will be able to be that light. Be that light for others so that others might know the great I am as well. Amen. Service this day, and the table out in the entry area, there are tea candles out there for each one of you to take a candle with you to remind you, since we don't have the acolytes taking this out, this is for you to take home with you, put somewhere to remind you that Jesus is the light of the world, and that through your work and your efforts, others can see the light. Go forth now in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit.